today to welcome Laura Levinson, Chief Creative Officer at Valdez Weavers, and Christy Almond, who is the VP of Marketing, and Wesley Mancini, who runs his own wing, Wesley Mancini Limited, and to do this really important program about Upholstery 101. And I'll just do a quick intro about why how this came about. I actually had a sales rep who we visited at market, and she requested some information about how she could talk about her about fabrics to her customers. She said, you know, I can tell them the chair, I can tell them a little bit about the color, but she said, I wanted to be able to talk about the fabrics and just do something basic. So it was, the idea was born. And I think this will be great information for people to be able to look back at too. So I'm going to turn the program over to Laura and Christy and Wesley. And thank you so much for being here.
You're very welcome, Amy. I'm going to go ahead and share my screen. Can everyone see that?
Yes.
Wonderful. So thank you, Amy and Kathy, for inviting us to speak today. We're excited to walk you through Upholstery 101. Valdez Weavers is a jacquard weaving mill located in Western North Carolina, and we're over 100 years old. We weave jacquard fabrics 24 hours a day. We make yarn, we dye yarn, we weave, and we finish fabric for fully vertical operation. I'll introduce my friends and colleagues. Christy Allman, she's our Vice President of Product Development and Marketing. She's been with us for 6 years. Wesley Mancini, as Amy mentioned, is president of Wesley Mancini LTD, and he's been in the industry 38 years and currently designs for all of our brands. And this is my 31st year with Valdez Weavers. So first we're gonna talk through fabric styles. Our hope is that you'll take away, you know, a couple of things that you can use, especially in selling fabric. We're gonna also review technical repeats, and then Christy's gonna finish with some basic performance information. So we'll start with printed fabrics. These are fabrics where the ink is applied to the surface of a fabric. You can see here the back of a print where the ink doesn't go through. Prints are usually recognized with a key on the side for the colors. The colors come from color chips. We use these for chipping out colors when we're developing prints and assign a color to every area. There are definitely several ways to print fabrics. The images on this screen, the first one is a silt screen method. This is more of a historical way of creating prints. The ink goes through the screen and onto the surface of the fabric. On the right is a hand blocked print. And here the artist is taking a carved piece of wood, stamping it into ink, and then stamping it on the fabric to create a pattern. The newer technology includes rotary printing and digital printing. In rotary printing, the engraving of these drums is quite expensive, but once you create the engraving, it's a very economical way to print. The ink is inside the drum and just comes through and is printing over and over as the fabric rolls through. On the digital side, this is the newer option. It's a little more expensive, but you can print discrete quantities. You can see how the pattern changed here because it's all programmed electronically. Dobby fabrics is where we'll start with weaving. It's very basic. It's over under, just like you would make a pot holder when you were younger or even today. Dobby fabrics are structures that are put on grid paper such as this, and then it yields these really beautiful patterns, but they're all simple and they tend to be about 2 inches in scale at the max. Jacquard weaving is the more complicated weaving style. Every end in the warp is tied to these heddles, so you can create intricate patterns on these looms. Here you'll see a paisley coming off of this tapestry warp, and you can see the pattern weaving here. Some of these have shuttles that are mechanically thrown across the loom, and some use air to move the shuttle back and forth. Leather and vinyls make up the second category. These can be dyed, these can be embossed, and they can also be printed on. Knits is probably the least likely used in upholstery. These are different loop structures. Here's a close-up of one from apparel, and then here's a knitted fabric used in upholstery. Embroideries are extremely popular today. They involve embellishing the surface of a fabric where the yarn is stitched on top. On the left, you can see machine embroidery. It's great detail. And there's a machine that embroiders back and forth. The middle is more of a crewel embroidery. And this is a wool yarn that's stitched in a chain stitch on top. And then on the right, you can see another example of different stitching techniques. Velvets are created on a very specific loom. You weave a loop and then you cut it to create this really nice plush surface. If you don't cut the loop, you get an épinglée. And so these are loops woven on a loom. And instead of cutting them to get the plush surface, the loop is left and it creates a really beautiful modern fabric. Kind of emulates a bouclé yarn. This is a hand loom that's weaving a velvet. These rods going under the warp are creating the loops. So you would either slice across this to create the plush surface or just pull the rod out and you'd get the loop. Also with velvet fabrics are cut and uncut velvets. So you can see an area here where the loops aren't cut. And then right next to it is a cut area giving you a lot of dimension. And then there's also a jacquard velvet. And these velvets are woven on jacquard velvet loom. So you have a cut area here for the pattern and then a recessed area that creates the jacquard. Ecots are really popular and a really beautiful pattern style. They're generally made with dyed warp yarns. And when you put the warp on the loom, the pattern shifts slightly and it creates this really beautiful jagged edge. Here's one that's been painted on a warp. And again, you can see just the slightly distressed edge that's creating this ecot pattern. Rug patterns are extremely popular. This category highlights cultures around the world. The global motifs come from areas such as Persia, Turkey, and other parts of Asia. We emulate them both in these five-star layouts as well as stripes. Next are damask patterns. These are patterns that typically are single layer. Most often you find them in a frame design. Here's a beautiful silk damask. And on the right is more of a fortuny damask. This one's printed to make it look like a watercolor painting. Tapestries are very technical woven fabrics. All of the color is coming from the warp, so it can be a very economical way to get a multicolor fabric, but it's also very difficult to design because you have very limited color choices, and it's all about how you blend the color. If you blend the yellow and the pink, you can get this really pretty salmon shade. You can mix it with black to get a dark red or white to get a light red. Emberlings are another beautiful pattern style, and they simply mean a pattern laid over a stripe. Typically, these are damask designs with a really beautiful decorative stripe overlay. Botanical fabrics, these refer to images, obviously, depicting natural plant life, tropical leaves, large tropical flowers, large leaves, and bright colors. These are also prints and wovens. Jacobeans are anchored with a large vine, and off of it come beautiful stylized florals, sometimes animals, really beautiful leaf designs. These come in embroideries, prints, and wovens. Animal skins, it's pretty straightforward. The variety of animal patterns used here are quite literal. They serve well as an accent pattern to almost any room setting. Toile is another pattern type that originated in a small town in France. It often depicts a scenic or an activity. They tend to be monochromatic in color, meaning just shades of a color, and they generally look like they've been painted with watercolors. I grouped the moire wood grain and marbled fabrics together. These have concentric lines that go around organic shapes, and they create, this kind of forms an overall structure. Geometrics are also a very literal pattern category. The patterns created from geometric shapes and often fun uses of color. Sometimes they'll have an Art Deco influence, and they're great for pillows. Realistic drawings anchor the floral category. Historically, we've been here with these beautiful five-star layouts, traditional paintings. And we've seen a lot of emerging florals with this more contemporary or stylized flower. Motifs for the paisley category originated in sort of a teardrop shape, and they can be in a half drop layout or an all over layout. Transitional is an interesting category. It's sort of halfway between traditional and contemporary. The edges of these patterns tend to be softer, a little more organic, creating a little bit more of a modern look. Contemporary, similar to contemporary art, the style uses bold shapes and colors. We often describe it as modern, retro, or even mid-century pattern types. And these are great for pillow opportunities. We use the term ditzy or chair scale fabric, and it refers to yarn that's floating on the back of a fabric. So here we have an accent color of a chenille, this sort of mocha color, and it's just a supplemental weft or yarn that's floating on the back and just pops up on the surface. Since there's a voided area, it makes it a much more economical way to add color to a fabric. And these are often chair scale fabrics. Planes and textures are our largest selling category if you think of the amount of fabric used for a sofa or a sectional. There are lots of different weave structures that make up this area. Plain weave is the first, and this is a very basic over-under way of creating fabric. A twill weave is recognized by a diagonal line. It goes in the right or left. This is largely used in making denim fabrics for jeans. And then on the basket weave, yarns are grouped together in the warp and the weft to create these beautiful chunky textures. Herringbones or chevrons are noted from their zigzag sort of weave structure. Rib weaves are created where literally there's a yarn going over a rib, and it creates this beautiful sort of modern surface. Honeycomb fabrics or waffle weaves are a three-dimensional weave, so you actually have depth within that weave structure. And then last are tweeds, deflective weaves, and houndstooth. Tweeds are really popular. They're very heathered fabrics, and they get their origin in menswear or men's suiting fabrics. Deflective weaves are yarns that float on the surface of a fabric. It can be in either direction, and it's repeated over and over. A houndstooth is a really small pattern with a jagged edge. Again, it has a nod to apparel fabrics, but makes for a really beautiful texture. And now Wesley's going to take you on a journey to learn about technical repeats in upholstery fabrics. Wesley, I think you're on mute.
Yeah, you need to unmute.
Sorry. I'm going to talk about scale and repeat sizes. The fabrics that I'm using to exemplify this are designs I did for the Valdez Weavers brands. So we talked about textures already. They're the smallest of the repeats, usually. So you can see in the scale, like 1 inch here. The next example is another textural plane. These are all about surface interests. And the most used fabric of all the types of fabrics we have, like Laura said. The next are small scale. And these are designs that would range from 0 to maybe 4 inches. They can be used on chairs. They can be used on pillows. Sometimes they're even used on sofas. The next one is just another example of a small scale design. Then we're going to chair scale. Chair scale is commonly said to be about designs that are fist size. So it's easy to see. And on the next one is another chair scale pattern. Even though all the motifs are different, the overall look looks like it's one design that's fist size. And then as we go up in scale, we have 13.5 inches square. This is the most used pattern design for furniture because it's the least waste of the feature patterns. And this would be used, like I said, for a chair. Next is another example of a chair scale pattern based on an ethnic rug motif. And then the next scale is the jumbo scale. This is 27 inch square, often used for pillows or on top of ottomans. It's for drama in the room. The next one is another large scale pattern. I'm all about drama, so it's great to have it in the room. Next, we're gonna start talking about repeats. Now, the most common repeats is the straight side by side. You take one block is the repeat. You take the left-hand corner of the green dot at the bottom, and you can see where it goes side by side and on top of each other. So that's where it gets side by side. And then here's an example of art where it's one square side by side stacked on top of each other. So you can see this in the lower left-hand corner, you see a taupe kind of diamond. That diamond is each left-hand corner. And then the art without the grid on it, you can see how it kind of all blends together. So the repeat size doesn't really stand out in your face. And then here's the fabric. Okay, next is another example of side by side with the left-hand corner, lower left-hand corner being the start of the arrow. And then without the grid, you don't see repeats. And then here's the fabric. And the next, that's another example. This time the rectangle is not a square, so it can be any kind of dimension. And then without the repeat. And then we're going to talk about mirror repeats. Now, if you look at the left-hand diagram, look at where the green dot is on the top left. And if you were to put a mirror down the very center of this, what you see on the left side is exactly what you see on the right side. So the green dot that was on the left corner of the top is now on the right corner of the top. And then in the larger illustration, you can see how it repeats. In the center, you have the two green dots pointing out. And then in the other center, you have the two arrows. So here's an example of it in fabric, where the design just mirrors on both directions. And then here's the grid with, the design without the grid. And then here's the fabric. Next is another example of a mirrored fabric, where you can see the lower left-hand corner is also the lower right-hand corner with the mirror effect. And here's the fabric. This is a larger scale design that would be used for bedding or drapery or even furniture. Next, this is a full wheel mirror repeat. So we start in the left-hand design or corner. If you take the top left corner with the green dot, you put a line down the middle of the repeat, and you can have a mirror so that the green dot is now on the top right-hand corner. Then you put a mirror underneath it so that that green dot now is at the green, at the bottom of the right-hand corner. You put another mirror there. It mirrors, so now the green dot is on the left-hand corner, and it just goes around and around. And then here's an example of the larger on the right side shows how it repeats, so that in one center you have all four arrows, and in the other center you would have all the green dots. Here's an example of it in fabric. It's a stylized zebra skin. And then here it is without, and here it is in fabric. So you're really not aware of how this, how these repeats work. The next one is another example of a Navajo blanket type design. It's also four wheel. So here it is without the grid, and then here it is in fabric, which is in the new inside out line for Valdez. You'll never look at a Navajo blanket again without realizing it's a four wheel mirror repeat. Next is the mirror half drop. So in the upper left corner, you take the two top squares, and you can see already that it's mirrored by where the two green dots are. So by half dropping it, you're taking the upper left-hand square and putting it in the lower right-hand square, and you're taking the upper right-hand square and putting it the lower left-hand. So in the larger illustration, you have blue lines around where the two motifs are mirrored, or the one motif is mirrored. But then when you half drop it, the lower box, lower row, the blue box is moved over halfway. And then that's how this motifs work. So in the example, it looks pretty straightforward as a damask motif, but you can tell in the very center, the line that the top right and left are mirrored. And then the lower right-hand corner square is the same as the upper left-hand corner square. Here it is without the diagram. And then here it is with fabric. And there's another example. This is also, well, okay. This is another example where you take the center and the top squares, mirror it, and then take the upper left and it becomes the lower right, and you take the upper right and it becomes the lower left. And then we're gonna see it without it. And then here's the fabric. And then next, we have half drop repeats. Now half drop, you can half drop from the top to bottom or from the right to left. So on the left, this is an example of moving the half drop over from the top and bottom. And you can see where the square is just moved over in the lower row, just halfway through. And then on the right example, the square is moved halfway down or halfway up. And here's examples of that. You can see where the red square or rectangle is moved halfway there in the middle. And then this is it without, and then this is the actual fabric. That's a simulation. So these are very common repeats. And keep going. This is another example of a half drop where the lower rectangle is moved over on the top, so that the lower left corner is now the middle corner. And then here it is without the lines, and here it is in repeat. Next is another example. This is half dropping from the side. So the geometric lines just move over and move down halfway. Here's the design without the grid. And here it is in the fabric. So the goal really is not to really have a repeat just glare in your face. You kind of want it all to just blend in. So next is another half drop to the side. This is more of a Moroccan influence. The lower left-hand corner is now the center corner. Here it is without the grid. And here it is in fabric. Next, is another half drop, but this half drops from the top. So the lower left-hand corner is again in the center. And then here we have it. And here's the fabric. Okay, this is a flip repeat. So in the top row, the arrows are going to the left. In the bottom row, the arrows go to the right. So you basically are just doing the mirror image, but on the bottom. This is not a common repeat. This was more important during the early 1900s and the 20s. Here's an example. And you can see where the lower, on the top row, that the lower right-hand corner is now the lower left-hand corner in the row below it. This is not so common today because of the amount of waste there is for cutting fabrics for upholstery. Next is an example. This is it in fabric. Next, half drop and flip repeat. Now this is really the rarest of repeats. And this was more popular in the early 1800s and late 1700s. So this is where you have your, in the upper left-hand corner, you have the arrow pointing up, and then to the right, the next row going down, the image is mirrored and the repeat goes downward. And then here it is without the grid, and here it is as fabric. Okay, next, we're gonna talk about mirrored stripes. And here's an example of starting at the top. If you were to put a mirror right down the center of that yellow line, what's on the left of the stripe is exactly what's on the right of the stripe. And it keeps moving out until you get to the center of the brown. Now in the lower row of red stripes, you have the brown center. And once again, if you were to put a mirror there, it absolutely, what's on the left side of that brown stripe is exactly what's on the right side of that brown stripe. Now, this is the most common kind of stripe. It's most efficient for upholstering because when you put the fabric up the front of the chair, it lines up with the fabric in the back of the chair. And here it is in fabric. And I think we have another example. And here's where the art from the center at the top goes out towards the gold, and at the bottom, the arrow goes towards the blue-green. Here's the fabric. And next, we have non-mirrored stripes. Now, non-mirrored stripes are stripes that there is no section in this particular design that mirrors. So this is more of a challenging for upholstering because in the front of the chair, it will look like this, but on the back, nothing will line up. And so that's can be a problem for the upholsterer. And here is the stripe in fabric. And then next is another example of a non-mirrored stripe that kind of looks mirrored, but if you look at the very center, the dark purpley blue, there's what's on the left is not what's on the right. And then here it is in fabric. Okay, next are all over patterns. Now all over patterns are patterns that you don't want anything to stand out. And these repeats can be any kind of repeat, side by side, half drop, whatever. So this happens to be a stacked repeat where you don't really see anything. Here it is without the grid. And here it is in fabric. Now these kinds of fabrics are really good because you don't have to match anything, so it's good for the upholstery. It's less yardage is required. Next is another example of an all-over. It just happens to be another stack design. This was a Brain Coral inspiration. Here it is without the lines, and here it is in fabric. It's very textural. Next is Christy Allman going to take over the performance fabric part of this.
Great, thank you so much. So now that you know the basic types of fabrics and how repeats works, you wanna make sure that your fabric is a good fit for your project. And I'm gonna walk you through some of the performance fabric basics to help you find the right option. So the first thing you really wanna do is start asking yourself some questions. Like, what is the main function of the space? Is it a high traffic area? Are you using it a lot for entertaining? Is it an indoor space or an outdoor space? What challenges does this space hold? Are there big windows with lots of sunlight? Do you have moisture, weather elements for outdoor spaces? And then what are you planning to upholster with the fabric? Is it going to be, or use the fabric, is it going to be drapery or an occasional chair? Is it a sectional that's used for lounging, an ottoman where you're going to have snacks and feet on them, or dining chairs that will get all of the above? Next. So the important thing to think about now is, how do you develop the right performance fabric? What options do you need to consider? And there are three main ways that you can achieve performance. The first one is through fiber and yarn type and how it's dyed. So not all fibers are the same. Some are inherently more durable than others. So the fibers that are being used are an important first step. And then how those fibers are dyed, that really impacts how color is binded to the fiber. So that has implications to how you clean it, can you use bleach, and how it reacts to light and sunlight. The second is how the fabric is engineered with an either immersion technology or surface chemistry and finishing. So that helps the fibers really become easier to clean. An example of that would be Krypton Home, or a simple stain and soil repellent finish. The advantage for immersion or surface technology is that you can use different fibers. And then the third is a blended technology that really combines the fiber, the yarn, the dyeing, and the finishing to give you a multifunctional option. An example of that is our Inside Out performance fabrics. So then the next thing is really understanding the key terms. And this really helps you make the best selection and manage the expectations of your clients. So in terms of durability, you really want to think about double rubs and pill resistance. So as you can see on the chart there, 30,000 to 50,000 double rubs is considered heavy duty upholstery. And 50,000 and above is really considered commercial grade upholstery. So that's really measured by Weizenbeek or even Martindale test. You can see to the bottom right, you take a swatch of fabric and it actually abrades the surface and measures the fiber and yarn breakdown, the surface breakdown, to see when visual wear starts to happen. So that just helps you understand how much double rubs you should consider if you've got a very high traffic area. And then pill resistance. I mentioned that not all fibers are created equal. Just like with your sweater, if you have a wool or acrylic sweater, they tend to pill. It's inherent in the fiber. So you've got to consider that basic platform when you're selecting something if you're looking for durability. Okay. Then cleanability. So if your space demands an easier cleaning story, you really need to consider what the fabric offers in terms of performance, and then how you want to treat the stain. So you've got stain resistance and liquid resistance. So the stain resistance helps you release any materials that land on the surface of the fabric. And then the liquid resistance is where the liquid actually beads up and does not absorb into the fabric or go into the yarn. And then on the right, you can see there are different ways to treat those stains. So a lot of performance fabrics can use soap and water. And this is typically a household detergent solution with water. And you really want to make sure you're following that performance fabric's cleaning steps. And then you've got fabrics that can withstand bleach, and there are different ratios of bleach to water that need to be considered as well. Some are 10 parts water to one part bleach. Others are more concentrated with 4 parts water to 1 part bleach. So it's really important that you read those instructions of your product and follow those directions. And also not all stains are created equal. So you want to know that if you've got different ones, which one's the best solution for that particular problem. Some other things to consider, you typically do not want to dry clean or use chemical cleaners on performance fabrics. You really want to follow the instructions that they've laid out for you. They've tested the fabrics to make sure that they withstand that cleaning recommendation. So make sure you do that. The other do not abrade the fibers with vigorous scrubbing. It is still a fabric and you can destroy the quality of the surface if you are going at it like it's a frying pan with debris on it. So you should really take a care, spraying, blotting as much as possible, and then following the progression of steps according to the type of stain. Do read the cleaning instructions. Like I said, that's really, really important. Not all instructions apply to all products. And then do maintain general care for your product. It's not self-cleaning fabrics. It does require vacuuming, dusting. And if it's an outdoor fabric, typically they recommend that you cover them just like you would other products for outside. Okay, now we can move on. Outdoor friendly. So some key terms here are fade resistance. And the goal here is maintaining color so that it can be exactly like you want it, despite the elements. And this can be a great feature, as I mentioned, for interior spaces as well. If you've got rooms with lots of lights, some of our customers have even commented in showrooms that have big windows that they've had color fastness issues with fabric. So interior spaces as well as exterior spaces. Quick dry, the goal here is that the moisture moves through the fabric and is not retained in the yarn. So you want a faster drying fabric that if it does rain and your cushions are uncovered, that it'll quickly dry for you. And just as a side note, the cushion insert is really important as well, making sure that you're using the right cushion insert that doesn't hold moisture in that part as well. And then the anti-mildew, important feature there is maintaining the cleanliness, because if you have debris on the surface, mildew can also stay on the, develop on the debris on the surface of the fabric as well. So you wanna keep the fabrics clean for outdoor use as well. Okay. And then just a note on environmental, it does come up occasionally with our clients. There are different options. There are C6 chemistry like a Krypton Home that is really a great bond. And like I said, can be used on a lot of different fiber types. It is the most tested chemistry out there, and it's used in many of your household products, including your cell phones. And for those that do not want to use that, there are PFC alternative options that are available. And then another thing to kind of look for is GreenGuard Gold. Both of those types of technologies, by the way, are GreenGuard Gold certified. And that's a testing organization that is especially used in the contract sector to make sure that fabrics are meeting the standards for contract and hospitality projects. And then just a new kind of arm that kind of tags on to performance in some way is environmental, and there are new innovations in environmental and sustainability that connects to performance as well. Recycling has been out on the market for a long time. Valdez has used recycled yarns for more than 20 years in our products. And that's really when you think about water bottles turning into yarn, and there are brands like Reprieve that we've used to tell that story. But there's some exciting new innovations in this area, one of which is plastics and materials that are being harvested from the ocean. So it's actually a problem solving initiative that we're working with Sequal. And it's really exciting because you're taking waste out of the ocean, sorting it, and turning it into yarn, weaving it into fabric, and helping solve a problem. So there's some exciting innovations there in environmental stories, and hopefully that gives you some great basics on what types of fabrics are available, how the repeats are laid out, and how you can use those to think about your efficiency and different attributes for performance fabrics. That's it.
Wonderful. So we are going to take some questions, and this is a great time for you if you've always wondered about some fabric or how to describe it to people that you are working with. And we did have one question early on in the chat about the warp. I don't know, Laura or Christy, if you want to talk about the warp and how that works.
Yeah, so in every loom, you have basically a yarn running vertical, that's a warp, and a yarn running horizontally, which is the weft. And it's the intersection of these two yarns that creates the structure of the fabric. And the warp is the vertical yarns. It's usually on beams, and it's running in the loom that's tied to those strings that I showed.
Yeah. Okay, does anybody, you are welcome to unmute yourselves. And if anybody wants to come on and ask a question.
I have a question. Laura, is there a limit to the number of weft yarns that can be used in a jacquard fabric? I'm sure there is, I just don't know what it is.
That's a great question, yes. There are 8 positions on the loom. So at any point, we can have 8 different yarns. They can be 8 different colors, 8 different yarn types.
Okay.
Dobby looms are either 4 or 8 as well.
Okay.
I have a question. Wesley, you did a really good job of explaining the very technical end of repeats. What about when a customer, a consumer, a designer asks, what's the repeat on this fabric? Can you talk a little bit about more what the visual repeat is or the practical end of that?
Each fabric is different. So it depends on what the fabric is, but if the repeat size is usually listed on a label, is it not? It's listed on our samples.
Mm-hmm.
And typically I would say you talk about the size. It's a 13.5-inch. We usually say half drop or 5-star or straight. Those are sort of the common ones. The structure underneath is the wheeling and the mirroring and everything, but you usually try to find that the edge of one color or one motif and the other edge. And then that increment is what it repeats like on the loom.
And that's really what consumers and, mm-hmm. and that's what you would print on a label then.
Yeah, and there's a little bit of a debate whether it's the measured repeat after it comes off the loom. Mm-hmm. And then sometimes we repeat multiple times in the warp direction to get all the color blocking in. And so it does get a little subjective at that point, but we like to say on the textile side, you know, it's where the pattern line starts and stops.
And it could also adjust with finishing. So
yeah, good point.
And the loom can only see it repeated over and over. So within the repeat, you're going to get the wheeling and the mirroring and all of that, but the loom has to have it in a really segmented repeat. So it's straight repeated over and over.
And I think Christy's point that it's fabric, it's going to have had a couple of processes before it gets to the consumer. So it might not be to the millimeter or to the 1/8 of an inch exactly what the label says. And some of that, how it looks on the chair and the end result can be a result of how tightly the upholsterer pulls it.
Exactly.
Yes. All those factors can definitely affect the ultimate size.
Hi, this is Jana. I want to jump in. Great, awesome presentation. Oh my gosh, there's so much I don't know about fabric. And I recognize trim in one of those embroideries, Laura, an embroidered tape. My question is this, though. It was so delicious to see all these patterns. And my question is, are these repeated patterns part for, you know, the end use? So some things are more chair specific or larger upholstery and such, depending on it's woven or printed. But is it also dependent upon what the machines or the looms can produce, the size of the pattern?
Yeah, I'll take it. The maximum repeat the looms can produce generally are 27 inches. So the repeat sizes that we use have to divide into that. So half of that is 13 and a half inches, which is what the most common repeat size is. And then if you took half of that or a third of that, for half it's 6 3/4, and then you can take half of that or a third of that. I mean, you just keep dividing down, but it has to repeat into that 13 and a half and 27 inch limitation.
They don't tell you how much math is involved in design school.
Well, thank you, that was great. Thank you.
So we have a question in the chat here. What type of performance fabric would you recommend for a client wishing for a white or cream colored sofa in a household with kids and a cat and a dog?
Well, I think one of the questions is what type of fabric are you looking to buy first? With Laura's assortment of options there are definitely a lot of different options. So if you're looking for velvet or chenille, that would be, could be different answers with different fiber types and different fabric types. But, you know, what we usually answer with our range of products that we offer would be one of our inside outs options, because you get the durability of 50,000 double rubs or more, and you can clean it with a bleach solution of, one part bleach to four parts water. So that way you've got a concentrated bleach and you can hold, it holds the color and is durable. That would be our best solution.
And the white fabric color choice is growing. It's probably one of our number one shades. So the pandemic sort of threw us a curveball in how do we make a white fabric perform in a great room with kids and wine and dog and people living there, you know, 24/7 these days. It's been quite a challenge, but as Christy mentioned, it really depends on the surface interest that you want. And then there are different levels, whether you want it, the stain to have a liquid repellent, a stain repellent, you just kind of have to figure out where in that scope you want to land. But it can be as durable as you want.
An interesting side note, people think that outdoor fabrics like white doesn't fade, but interestingly enough, white turns yellow. So there is a light fastness and color stability that has to be considered with a white fabric option as well.
Caroline.
Great question. Yep. Caroline.
Hi, everybody. Y'all did a beautiful job, Christy and Wes and Laura. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
You know, I've been lucky enough to be at the factory at your plant for Textile 101. Do you think you'll resume those in person once COVID is better, or what are you thinking about that?
Absolutely. We're actually renovating our showroom. It started today, of course, right while we're speaking, but we're hoping, you know, as we're allowed more gatherings to be ready. We see customers starting to travel in April, a few have started already. So we're kind of looking at aftermarket. You know, we had to cancel. That was our last cancellation before everything shut down, was a really large 40 person tour of our facility. So we're going to sort of build our way back up to it, but we're actually working through that so that we can accommodate even more people as they ask.
We have our whole fabric department is black in there somewhere watching. And so I'm so glad they got to see you all, but I look forward to having more travelers and to come to see your amazing facility.
Absolutely. We were ready. Yeah. We've been open the whole time. And, you know, anytime this summer, I think we would welcome groups coming through again. So we're trying to slowly get back to that and hopefully be even better on the other side of this.
And we will be set up at our outreach gallery at the Still Building for pre-market and market as well for anyone who wants to come by and take a look at a demo, see how the fabric works for itself, or have any questions about any of our products. So, and of course, Showtime.
Great. So I have another question here in the chat from Shelley. She says, do you have natural based fabrics in your performance line, like linens or wools?
Yes. So we do have natural fibers, and Krypton Home is a great option for anyone who's looking for those products. So when we're working with Wes's higher end collection or some of our Circa products where you have cottons or rayons, we don't do a whole lot with wool, but we have had linens. That's the best performance option for a natural fiber.
I have a question. Oh, go ahead, Ellen.
That's okay. Go ahead, Jan. Sorry.
I was interested in what's happening with yarns, because I know that affects what you can do with design and weaving so much. And there are constant evolutions in yarn spinning. So I'm just curious about that aspect. And that can be for any or all of you.
We make a lot of our yarn here, so we are able to experiment sort of firsthand, jump on our machines when they aren't running, which these days they've been running quite a bit. And then we do work with, we have global suppliers that we work with on R&D. But we're seeing a lot of textural yarns, multicolor yarns. And then we're having to make sure we have white in every yarn. That's become such an important part.
We're also doing a lot with our slubs and boucles, really evolving those novelty looks are really important as people kind of look at those like heirloom, handcrafted types of textiles, getting things as irregular looking, but still maintaining quality and production is a challenge. Manufacturing loves it when we challenge them with yarns like that, but those kind of looks, drier kinds of comfortable, cozy, and then some of our really plush soft chenilles for performance as well.
It's definitely changing. I mean, it's amazing to see our performance yarns. They're our top sellers now as far as the warps go, and it's shifted so dramatically in just such a short amount of time. We can't give away a tapestry right now, but we hardly get enough performance woven and out the door. So we're really, you know, performance is sort of the overarching hierarchy that we're using when adding new components.
Mm-hmm. Hi, this is Kathy. Great job. Good to see everybody, Wesley, Laura, and Christy. Thank you so much. So informative and educational. Just question about market. I heard you say about pre-market and market. What's your participation with First Tuesday? It's getting quite a bit more buzz. I guess as it started along, are you participating or what are you hearing?
We are. We have our steel space that we have left up and running for the Tuesday shows, and then we're going to be ready for pre-market. We think customers are going to sort of trickle in between April, May, and June. But we open that showroom. We don't open our Hamilton space during the Tuesday shows, but we do everything by appointment right now anyway, in between the show times. So it's all intact, and we have our showroom manager there helping people.
Thanks.
Ellen,
I had a question.
Yeah.
I had a question that was based on, first of all, there's two parts. One is as looking at what Wesley was showing us in terms of mirrored fabrics and the repeats and stuff. That's something you learn in school, I guess. Like, can you look at a fabric and know, oh, you just put a mirror to that and then you see it three ways? Is that something that just over time becomes just natural for y'all? Because as many showings as I've been in, I'm going, I never noticed that. So I just think that's amazing to look at that.
Yeah, well, with practice, makes perfect. Some of them are harder to tell, like that that wheel pattern or the flipped, half dropped, but those are pretty rare. The basic repeats really stand out the most.
I think we learned it, or I learned it especially with hand printing fabrics, because we had to create our own art and then we had to create our own screens and then we had to repeat it over and over. So sort of that maker style of learning, hands-on was the way that it really clicked for me.
Same with me for prints, really made it happen. And as Wesley said, if you don't know, then we've done our job. So that means if you're not seeing it everywhere blocked out, it does make us repeat nerds. I don't know about you guys, but when I see a carpet that has a pattern that's disturbingly rhythmic in a bad way, it drives me crazy. Or a friend had a tile pattern that the tile maker who was laying it down didn't repeat out the tile correctly. And so once you see it and you know these repeats, you definitely start looking for them, I think, in the world around you.
And you cannot unsee it.
So from a consumer standpoint, you know, I was just thinking about that with tile. Some tile people say start in the middle and go out. Some people say start over the end and go forward to the corner. For upholstery, when you're reupholstering, how do we teach consumers the best way to reupholster furniture even? Or, you know, yeah, we talk about waterfall and that sort of thing. How do we start getting consumers to know not only about the best things to look for, but also, you know, you talked about double rubs. Well, the term double rubs has been in the industry forever and never with the term performance. We talked about how the fabric wore, but all of a sudden performance is meaning lots of different things. So just two parts to that.
But as far as like the aesthetic of the fabric, if there's a major motif, that's what would be centered on a cushion. Now, whether or not someone wants to take that major motif and put it over on the side of the cushion, that's up to them for their creative license.
We tend to practice it. So we'll actually take a cushion and drape our fabric over it. And you can kind of see if the edges fold around and you don't get it centered perfectly on the pillow, then it's typically not a great choice for that. I think diagrams are helpful. And then also the photography so that you can show the repeat layout. As far as the consumer goes, but that's a great point.
And in terms of the performance, it's training, 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 more training, so, you know, and making sure that you get those basic terms understood, and managing expectation is so important. We do lots of training and we hear those reps then go to train other people and they're like, you can do anything. We're like, no, you can't do anything. It's still fabric. Yeah. And, you know, not overselling, really understanding the limitations, but that this is making your life easier. It's far different than fabrics of even 15 years ago. So there's some exciting innovations for it, but.
And Inside Out is our first consumer brand. So we've been on the road training folks in retail environments and fabric sales reps, just trying to understand the nuances of performance. Because there is a shared vocabulary and every fabric is slightly different. So Christy's done a great job putting it all in a matrix for us so that you can see which boxes it checks off.
Right. I have a question. We're seeing a lot more upholstered furniture, sofas with bench cushions, one long single cushion. And that creates a bit of a challenge, I think, for fabrics with repeats. Do you have any guidance there?
Well, I hope you're using patterns on sofa. That's exciting. We are seeing a trend to that. While we love textures and the volumes, we also love jacquards because that's our specialty. Right. But I think, you know, Wesley's got several different repeat options. Wesley, I don't know if you want to speak to it, but all overs.
Yeah, well, if on a long bench, you'd have to do something railroaded, or you if you did it up the road, you'd have two seams.
Right.
But if it's a design that can be railroaded, then it works out perfectly for you.
Great point.
Okay.
Oh, you're muted, Amy. Sorry.
I was afraid my phone would start ringing. We're right here at 1 o'clock and I want to be respectful of everybody's time, but I want to say a huge thank you to Laura and Christy and Wesley, because this was a lot of work to put together, but we so appreciate the education. And so I will upload this to YouTube and I will send everybody a link, and you are welcome to share these links and send them to your customers or to people who are asking you questions or someone else that you know that needs to know this. And thank you again to Valdez Weavers and Inside Out Performance Fabrics for bringing this really important education to us.
Thank you, everybody, for taking the time.
We appreciate it. Have a great day.
Bye, everyone.
Thank you, Wisit, too.
Yeah.
And Valdez.